Okay, dear guests. Let's begin this session. This session is about finished vehicle logistics. Apart from trade policies, some other impacts may come from the logistics range. It covers a whole spectrum of things. In China, we have a saying, nothing can be, everything can be put into this basket of logistics. So that's why it delivers a huge impact upon the import and export of finished vehicles. So how to make a better use of the effective logistics services to enhance the service qualities is key. A follow-up session on the previous one, we have three guests or speakers who will address different facets of the difficult issues or the hotspot issues of the logistics sector. They are having a diverse background, business managers or some inside experts. The first speaker is Mr. Vice President Liu Shiqing from Xiamen Huashang Logistics. He will bring a presentation on Belt and Road Initiative and how what we can do in this initiative. It is worth mentioning that Mr. Liu has a lot of experiences in the railway industry. Over yesterday's presentation, we heard something about like the reform of the railway sector, and Mr. Liu is one of the few experts who have not only rich experiences in the railway sector but also have a lot of good expectations and good suggestions for the future. So Mr. Liu Shiqing will be a very proper and a suitable speaker to be the first keynote speaker. Well, it really humbles me after listening to the presentation, to the introduction. First of all, a few words about my company. I come from Xiamen Huashang Logistics Company Limited. Our company was registered in Xiamen, our headquarters in Shanghai. So it's an international company for logistics industry, and we handle both airway, railway, e-commerce, insurance, and other modes of transportation. In America, Hong Kong, Russia, UK, Latvia, we have our own subsidiary companies. We are new entrant into the auto logistics industry, so I wish to get to know more of you in the future. So this is an introduction of our company. I want to thank Mr. Zhang for his kind remarks. I've been working in the railway industry for over 20 years, mainly dealing with real operations of container transportation. I did two things basically over the past two decades. First, I tried a case of a so-called milk train. The milk train linking Shanghai, Guangzhou, and Hohhot. So it started from year 2003. I was the initiator of this project. And this project has given birth to the high growth rate of the Yili Mengniu, who is the leading player in the dairy products in China. So this is the first thing. The second thing is that from year 2000, we have been dedicated to the container transportation between Shanghai, China, Russia, especially between Beijing, Moscow, to Middle Asia, and for and further down to the final destination in the Eastern Europe. So this line, this route, is called a China-Europe route. It's an integral part of the Belt and Road Initiative, and I myself is being privileged as a part of this project. So it gives me extra pleasure to be here, standing upon such a rich body of knowledge and tell you a little bit about the status quo development of the China-EU and the China-European trains linking belts and roads. There are four parts of my presentation. So what's the China-Europe train? Talking about the definition, you know, different provinces and autonomous regions are also having different ways of interpreting the so-called trains linking China and Europe. To be more specific, it's regular trains linking China and Europe. It's container train, regular trains from end to end. So far, each train has around 41 compartments, and for each compartment, it contains one 40 feet container or two 20 feet long container. So this is called a standardized regular train arrangement between two destinations. Because of different requirements from the customers and a different load requests, so at a different sections, the length of the train is also different. Within China, not altogether, it's about 50 parts long. And when it comes to the Europe or CIS states, so we are operating on wider rail through Russia, Belarus, and Malaszewicz. In Europe, then we will switch to the so-called Poland trains. So within the Poland section, the length is about 41 parts long instead of 50 parts long. So this is some of the key milestone events over the past 6 years of a China-European regular train. Yuxing O was initiated in year 2011, which is the first page of the regular train arrangement between China and Europe. Yuxing O is a marvelous project. In order to attract more business to Chongqing, because you know Chongqing has no advantages for air transportation or ocean transportation, that's why we have opened a rail transportation modality to invite more goods and commodities to Chongqing. So this is really one of the high efficiency arrangement between Europe and Chongqing, providing a very good platform for the imports and exports between the two continents. So their mission is to use the rail speed and operating on a low cost in the ocean industry. So normally around 15 days will be the standardized time span between the dispatch of the goods to the final recipient, the reception of the goods. So you can see that on 2012, in year 2012, 2013, we have launched different lines. So we have a Haizhou logistics company of Xiamen. It's also involved in the Xiao line launching. In year 2014, in Xinjiang, it also launched its a special train to Turkey.
And also there's a train connecting Yingkou and Moscow and Changsha to Louisburg. And Mr. Chen from Changzhou Logistics gave you similar explanations on introductions. And in 2016, a train connecting Xi'an and Warsaw was established. And also a train connecting Xi'an and Madrid was launched in 2016. So far, we have a total of 18 trains connecting Chinese cities to Europe. This is the statistics for the operation of the China-Europe trains in the past 6 years. In 2011, there were only 16 trains going between China and Europe. And in 2016, there were a total of 2,156 trains going between China and Europe, meaning there were at least six trains a day connecting China and Europe. This is a normal number for a railway operation. If you take a look at the statistics in the past 6 years, the inbound trade is only 34.7% of the total inbound and outbound trains. For container transportation, we want round trips transportation, of course. But if we ship the containers to Europe, these containers won't be able to transport it back to China because there's no cargo, not enough cargo to go back from Europe to China. I think you all understand what I mean by that. So in order to sustain the operation of a rail train, we must have sufficient cargo volume. So when we first set up China-Europe trains, it was all for the export. Different provincial government provided subsidies to sustain the operation of these outbound trains to facilitate export. But later on, we found that if there's not enough inbound cargo volume, it would not be economically feasible to sustain the operation of a China-Europe trains. We're all in the spare parts business. If you have any import requirement or demand, you can contact us, you can contact these train companies. They love to give you subsidies so that you can carry the goods from Europe to China. Well, the freight they offer is highly competitive. So if you need some market statistics, you can talk to me offline. Well, this is statistics covering the China-Europe trains connecting 18 Chinese cities to Europe in 2016. Chongqing, Chengdu, Wuhan, and Yingkou these cities can sustain at least three trains a week to Europe. Three trains a week or one train every 2 weeks makes that train a regular product. If you take a look at the frequency of the trains going between China and Europe, well, the operation of this China-Europe trains has been normalized and it covers all parts of China. If you do have any cargo transportation need, just contact us. Let's make sure that we can continue to ensure the prosperity of these trains. Secondly, I'm going to talk about the main passages of these trains. There are three main passages: the East Passage, Middle Passage, and the West Passage.
Mm-hmm.
It represents the East Passage from Manchuria to Russia, Belarus, Poland, and then into the hinterland of Europe. This is a very traditional China-Europe passage via Russia, the Halbin trains and Sumanha trains, and all the trains in Shenyang and Changchun use these lines to reach Europe. This is what we call the East Passage or Corridor. Well, this is a line connecting Erlian, Haute, and Mongolia, and then Russia, Poland, into the hinterland of Europe. This is what we called the Middle Passage. We're doing experiments in Zhengzhou and Tianjin. Well, this passage is not very successful or popular because of some issues in Mongolia. The third passage or corridor is what we call the West Passage or corridor. 80% of the China-Europe trains use this passage. And this line is also known as the Continental Bridge. It starts from Lianyungang in the east and to the Rotterdam in the west. At the west end, take Yuxing O, Zhengxing O, and Hanxing O. Well, these trains use this passage. And probably this passage is most frequently used by China-Europe trains. From a political as well as an economic point of view, we are exploring other passages connecting China and Europe. This is from Huashang Valley to Kazakhstan. And then it goes into the sea, takes a ferry to Baku, and across Azerbaijan to Croatia, to the Black Sea, and then to Europe. I think I was personally involved in the establishment of that kind of a transportation passage or route. Because of some cost issues, the route itself has not been widely used, but technically there's no technical issue involved. So this is a pretty safe passage or corridor. And this passage connects China to Iran, and it dovetails the Asian Silk Road. I've been in Xinjiang Autonomous Region for 5 years, and during my stay in Xinjiang Autonomous Region, I advocated the establishment of that passage, but because of the inefficient railroad infrastructures in the northern part of Iran, that passage has not been fully established yet. Another passage is called Yingman O. So the route is like this. It starts from Manchuria to Russia. Instead of going to Belarus, it actually goes into Ukraine and then to Slovak and then into Europe. I understand you are concerned about the relations between Russia and Ukraine. Well, I personally investigated into this passage, and I can tell you very happily that indeed we can ensure the safety and security of the operation on this passage. And thirdly, I'm going to talk a little bit about the preparations for the cargoes for the China-Europe trains. Household appliance and electronics and tires and other light products are the most constituents for the cargoes going into the Western Europe. Toys, suitcases, mostly for the Eastern Europe. Construction materials, steel machineries for Russian market. For mid-Europe, we got household appliance, vehicles, and tires. These are the cargoes for the mid-Europe. So what is actually the basis to sustain the operation of this China-Europe train? Well, actually, the cargo volume is the fundamental requirement for the operation of these trains. The Chongqing train is very successful. Even if the government stops subsidizing the Chongqing trains, well, the train itself is still economically viable because there's a huge trade demand between China and Europe via Chongqing. So the Chongqing Municipal People's Government takes out a part of its tax revenues, earmarks part of its tax revenues to subsidize the operations of the trains connecting Chongqing and Europe. The cargo volume is of crucial importance. So what kind of cargo? Now I'm on an automotive logistic conference. I think probably in the future the car parts will be a very important cargo source for China-Europe trains. Changzhou Logistics has been doing pretty well in this regard, and I do hope that other automotive spare parts companies or other OEMs should consider the application of this train seriously. Well, there is a timely and regular operation of the trains connecting Chongqing and Europe. And indeed, the China-Europe trains cover almost every part of China with very competitive freight. So probably you should consider this option of transportation very seriously. I helped to design and develop many new trains connecting China and Europe. So if you're interested in using that kind of transportation, I can help you to get to know some people or give you some contact numbers with some companies operating these China-Europe trains. And I do hope that car parts will become a dominant cargo for China-Europe trains. This is the breakdown of the cargo volume. It took 4 years to grow from 1 to 500 trains between China and Europe. And it took 7 months to grow from 500 to 1,000. And it took 5 months to grow from 1,000 to 1,500. 3 months from 1,500 to 2,000. And less than 2 months, and it took less than 2 months to grow from 2,000 to 2,500. And from 2,500 to 3,000. So we can see the number of trains going between China and Europe are growing rapidly. And these trains become the backbone transportation between China and Europe. This is how we amass the cargo for Yuxing. These trains go directly into the manufacturing site. And Chongqing wants to turn itself into a transportation hub in southwest China, and Chengdu also has the hope to turn itself into a transportation hub in southwest China. So these two cities are competing with each other fiercely. Well, for the trains from Chongqing, they have sufficient local cargo source. Liaoman, all trains from Shenyang to Ouzhou, and also there is a train from Yingkou to Europe. So they amass the cargo through sea transportation. Lianxingya starts from Lianyungang to mid-Europe. Well, it has a lot of cargo source from South Korea and Japan. Zhengzhou Europe trains. In 2014, when I was in Xinjiang Autonomous Region, I did some preliminary work for the establishment of the Zhengzhou Europe trains. And I remember in 2014, I talked with a local custom house in May and had a conference on that topic in July that year. During the conference, I told the audience that the local government in the city of Zhengzhou would like to provide the subsidies to cover the freight up to 1,500 kilometers. Well, so far, it's economically viable to operate the trains connecting Zhengzhou and Europe. As I said, I've been in Xinjiang Autonomous Region for 5 years, and I did quite a bit of work to develop these China-Europe trains. There's not enough, of course, there's not enough cargo source in Xinjiang Autonomous Region, and there's not enough fiscal support from the local government because they have to spend a lot of money in fighting against terrorism in Xinjiang Autonomous Region. But right now we're trying to generate more local cargo to economically sustain the operation of the trains going through Xinjiang Autonomous Region. These are some of the main products going between China and Europe. So if the products of your company happen to fall into these categories, well, you can contact me or contact other operating companies. This is a train connecting Chongqing to Louisburg. And another train connecting connects Chengdu to Rhodes. Well, the total tenure is about 14 days for a single trip. And Zhengzhou to Hamburg represents another train. And these three trains are doing pretty well. Suzhou to Warsaw on trains. It's doing fine, and also there is a train connecting Suzhou to Moscow. Well, from Wuhan to Czech Republic, there is a train. Wuhan was one of the first comers in setting up the trains connecting China and Europe, but the operation suspended a little bit, but now they resumed operation. And Wuhan has become a distribution center for the wines from France. And also there is a train connecting Changsha to Louisburg, and a train connects EU to Madrid and Harbin to, also a European city, and Harbin to Hamburg, and Xining to Antwerp, and Guangzhou, Moscow. Xi'an to Warsaw. This is an incomplete list of the trains between China and Europe. Shenyang to Moscow. It's doing pretty well. And Shenyang to Moscow. Well, last week I was invited by the local authority in Xiamen because they want to set up a train connecting China to Europe starting from Xiamen.
So what I want to wrap up is that we cannot live without rail, and sometimes we're We are unwilling to work with rail, so this is really quite an ambivalent feeling. That's the traditional image of the railway sector in China, but after so many years of hard work, ever since especially year 2013, we have achieved a lot. We have worked out new steps towards marketization. Especially the launch of the regular trains between China and Europe, we can ensure that the running time is somewhere around 15 days, linking two destinations from different continents. It's sufficient enough to prove that we have worked out the first initial and important step. In the future, I hope you can be more interested in working with us, and we are willing to offer more help and services to you to our best, and to ensure that we can serve as a bridge to make more contribution. So I talked a lot about international transportation, but still we have done a lot for the domestic transportation. In China, the transportation total volume through rail is about 140,000 trains. In the future, there will be huge room for improvement. So that's why I'm calling your attention not only to international but also for domestic dimensions. So if you have any further interest, I'm willing to help you to devise and to develop some new ways out. This can help us to ensure that a railway is another important link of modern transportation. And we hope to take a much bigger market share. Okay, thank you. Okay, four parts have been covered. For the Belt and Road train industry and also the railway sector, so this has become top of our agenda of attention. It is important to mention that interconnectivity is really the center of attention. So Belt and Road Initiative, in essence, it is designed to fulfill connectivity. Against such a backdrop, what can we do? So probably the China-Europe train is only one side of the whole story. So that's why we'll have the second speaker, Mr. Huang Yingming, General Manager from Shanghai Origin International Logistics, to give a presentation on the application and the prospects of logistics against the backdrop of interconnectivity. So over to you, Mr. Huang. Today I want to share with you the vehicle and spare part application practice and expectation in the context of connectivity, especially from the IT perspective for the information application, information technology application. There have been a lot of new room of improvement given the new changes of the policies and regulations. So we have a lot of practices for Origin, which is the company's name. We have some best practices to share. First of all, marketing environment. Last month, especially the Shanghai center for the checking of bills has been further forwarded to Ningbo, and for finished vehicles and also for spare parts, the customs office has really changed their practice. Instead of a spot-based way of management, they have resorted to a collective way of management for batch-based processing. Unlike in the past, we have the advanced consultation, but now we have the so-called post-inspections. So such a post-inspection method has brought us to a new area of attention. And also it raised new requirements for technologies, for competencies, and also for the insights and knowledges. And also for the inspection and quarantine system, it's launched about 2 months ago. So 3C certification and the 3C certification for food sector is also going on very smoothly, and this will also deliver huge impact upon us companies. And also, all the so-called free trade zones have also been well connected with each other. The bill of lading actually can really be interconnected with each other on a wider basis, and especially on an IT-enabled platform. So such a type of a new practice will also be meaning something different, especially for such practices as import rebate, the tax rebate, and for some other sectors. For bonded zones, for trade zones, some supporting policies need a lot of room to change the original practice and also to embrace a new practice. And such an endeavor should be accomplished through the efforts from both sides. So from the company's perspective, we have done a lot. But whether in the whole process of management, we have taken into consideration the policy changes and also the changes of the regulations of the customs. For example, for some of the trade barrier issues, we have so-called anti-dumping policies. And for some purchasing suppliers management, it has also been involved into a new system which can be governed differently from the previous practice. So for the companies, probably originally our original attention is on the analysis of the cost and the benefit instead of putting a lot of focus on the properties of the commodities. In addition, the governments also have raised new requirements for the inspection and also the verification of the data. So it raises new requirements for the data centers for each company. Once there's something wrong with our data center, then you will see new problems down the road. So it will hamper the deliveries, especially the on-time deliveries of the goods. So enterprise resources planning, logistics systems, information data center, together with information sharing are the important elements to mind for the internal management or the internal environment. So say a few words about the current logistics data management. First of all, it's a collection of data and the reclassification of the database. It covers the area of work for both engineers and also for the information managers. The so-called pre-classification system is not only required by the custom office, but also required by the inspection bureau. In the whole process, we also have to take into consideration the certificate of a place of origin. In the past, probably one product may have 40,000 different types of market names. So for different names, maybe there is a different way to obtain its place of origin certificate. For finished vehicles, we have to also consider different bilateral arrangements, agreements, consultations between China and Europe and some other countries in the world. So these are all important to note while we are preparing for the fleshing out of such a database. Secondly, management of the whole process, how to streamline and optimize the whole process at the port levels, how we can shorten the time span. In the past, about 3 to 5 days, but now we can really shorten to about 1 day longest. This is the necessary requirement before we can embrace the new policies of so-called free trade zones in China. So there are a lot of nitty-gritty details required for embracement of the preferential policies of the trade zone. So if you can really talk better to the new policies of the free trade zone, then I think all of the links, all of the operational routes of your businesses in the past can be well streamlined. So another key factor is the so-called integration of internal trade and international trade. Besides, you have your own competencies to be further improved to a new high. This is what we have been doing so far, and we will do it even better in the future. So what is really behind is the changes of the customs clearance system and also the port code different systems and also the new policies of the free trade zone. So this is very important to help us to elevate the role of Shanghai as an important hub for the transportation and the transfer of goods. So such a mentality will be with us for long, and we need a special toolkit, and also we need a special team to handle these affairs. Eventually, our purpose is to ensure automated customs clearance. It will tell you instantly what is the name of the product and how to change the process and how to facilitate the process. So this is an example for the spare part. No matter what it is called, it's a special product, so we can see what is the tariff, the best tariff policy will be applied here. For all the customers we encounter, probably none of them have such thinking, but in our system, you can see this is a monthly custom clearance taxation a tariff rate optimization suggestions. So we compare different agreements based upon which different taxes will be levied, and you can compare by yourself as to which one is the best for you. So we have a lot of successful examples, and this one is a case study on a auto spare part import case. So one single year, we saved around $60 million of tariff for that particular company. And also, we have accumulated rich experiences for the customs clearance. The cost benefit can be well above $100 million US dollars. So currently, the ports including Dalian, Yantai, Shanghai, and Nanjing are the areas in which we have the data collection capabilities. And also we have extra capabilities to serve more clients to facilitate the customer clearance within around 4 hours. So in the past, probably the time can be even longer, and all the documents will have to be collected well in advance. And this will also cause the delay at different parts of the port. Considering the different specifications of the containers or different sectors, so probably some of the reasons cannot be well explained, but through our system, you can not only ensure JIT on-time delivery, but also ensure short clearance, short and fast clearance at customs. For the inspection of key articles, well, I think you can also generate a huge benefit for you, because we provide services to many different companies, especially big companies. So for different companies, we have something in common. So we have put all those commonalities into one system, and all these commonalities will become our core so-called database, and we can deliver really cost-efficient solutions to those who are in need of those suggestions from us. This is also a very good example, not only from spare parts, but also for a maintenance part import, especially for purchasing link. For some products, the supplier cannot provide some draft papers or some relevant and necessary documents. This will also cause the delay of obtaining the so-called 3C certification letter. And that will also cause the overstocking or overpiling of the stocks at the warehouse. So we have done something in this regard to facilitate the clearance of the maintenance parts by avoiding the trading risks. The average custom clearance is around 8 hours, so it can not only reduce the cost of logistics, but also save a lot of your money for the tax and cost. How we can put all together these functions in one system? I think we can do more sharing in the future. So auto is only one part of the whole story. We can really do something beyond this auto industry and try to include more regions and more sectors together. Talking about FTZ in Shanghai is the first of its kind in China. We have seen great innovations of the first FTZ in China. For example, in the future, we are going to see more integrations of both internal trade and external trade. So this FTZ is not likely, is not only going to overtake that of Hong Kong or Singapore, but also facilitate the export. So hopefully these are the functions to be further integrated within FTZ in Shanghai. Secondly, it will really seek to diversify some of the necessary means for the supply chain financing. At least it can solve some of the problems related to the parallel import issues in China. And also, probably another way out is to expand such a practice on such parts like maintenance parts or logistics parts using the supply chain financing means to solve the problem related to the interest spread of capital use, both offshore and offshore. With the development of Belt and Road Initiative, some new regions, some new FTZs are coming out. Just now, some colleagues have mentioned that the Belt and Road Initiative will benefit Chongqing, Chengdu, and Xinjiang, mainly. So if you can really acquire your own competencies for the management of a database, well, you can, of course, become a so-called sub-warehouse of the Belt and Road route. This will also help us to clarify and smooth out the routes for better transportation efficiency. For end-to-end logistics transportation and for each warehouse management, and the positionings of each warehouse, there could be some major adjustments. So it's great for me to see so many old friends here. You have been our long-term supporters to Origin. Over the past 10 years, since day one till now, we cannot go without your support. So this is some milestones we have achieved so far. So in the future, we hope to work even with you even more closely to co-share the benefit of the latest innovations of the industry. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wang. You give us two vivid examples, which helped us to understand how to ensure the maximized visibilities for the logistics of the whole vehicles as well as the car parts. Information is the basis for transparencies and visibilities in logistic process. Well, the Chinese economy is changing. The development of Chinese economy is changing its gear. And at the same time, the automobile industry is also in the face of gear changing through a series of innovations, the technology and interconnectivity enable us to do a better job in establishing the good fundamentals for the logistic industries in China. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentations. Apart from car parts, you also talked about using information technologies to facilitate the process, for example, custom clearance. Custom clearance is more than the sharing of data. It can optimize your decision-making process, but in import and export business of car parts, as well as in domestic trade of car parts, and especially international trade of car parts, that is the standardization of international packaging, which has a far-reaching effect and influence over the seamless integration of the supply chain and logistic chain. Our guest speaker says, a very rich experience in this regard. Now let's invite Mr. Sun Yan, the chairman of Anwood Logistics System, to deliver a speech. Ten more minutes to go. I'll try to speed up and improve the efficiency. I'm going to spend 10 minutes to tell you some of our observations in packaging. China is the largest automobile manufacturers and the largest automobile market. And probably in the near future, we're going to export more to the international market. So we need to take a look at the international standards and its relationships with the automobile industry in China. Well, before that, I'm going to tell you the role we're playing in the supply chain decision-making process. We have different roles to play, of course, in the logistic industry and supply chain. And some of these roles have conflict of interests, so I'd like to share with you my observations on these different roles. So first of all, let's focus on user. Well, the other role is management, the third role is about process, and fourthly, I'm going to talk a little bit about the rules and regulations. So in establishing an international standards for packaging, these are four important influencing factors. As a company, our car part suppliers, tier one suppliers and tier two suppliers and OEMs, we all have a role to play in the logistic industries. We have our positions to take in the supply chain. Maybe we should also take into consideration the environmental concerns for the supply chain. The second point is about communication. Well, the Chinese automobile industry comprises of different levels. There were Chinese branded OEM, joint venture OEM, and an internet-based OEM, which manufactures electric vehicles. So according to our experience, communications is very important. These communications sometimes takes up a lot of time. Well, probably in the past we simply focused on the communications that would result in yes or no, but probably in the future we're going to focus on things that will lead to a better common future. First of all, we should communicate more on the fundamental issues for the whole industry. The discussion sometimes takes up too much time, and the time left for execution is not enough. Sometimes there's not enough time for us to make preparations for the packaging issues. Packaging is an inevitable part in the automobile industry. So when do we start this role? How are we supposed to plan our manufacturing? Well, it's of crucial importance to the establishment of a efficient and secured supply chain. And this is a very long decision-making chain. The top circle represents the decision maker, but in the decision making process there were so many conversations, discussions happening at the grassroots level. For packaging industries, according to my observation, it is not a very deep industry. It is not an industry of that requires a multi-level structure. There were different opinions with regard to the investment in the packaging industry. A lot of companies don't have a clear strategic vision as to which direction they should move toward. And there are many short-term behaviors taking place in this industry, and there is a lack of long-term vision in the packaging industry. At least we need to have a long-term target, and we must have some guidelines and principles to follow. We found that at the very beginning, our domestic partners have very high requirements for us. But I think we should approach that ultimate target by several stages. We cannot reach the destinations by one leap and bounce. And another commonly raised question is whether we should focus on domestic market or international market. There were speakers from Changjiao Logistics and there were speakers from other logistic companies. They talked a lot about the internationalizations of the Chinese logistic companies. Well, these are something that needs to be pondered over by strategic decision maker. But for the automobile industry in China, we're facing a global issue instead of a local or regional issue. So we have to think globally. Well, our continental plants had a total of 34 different kinds of containers and rackets, so there was the excessive diversity of packaging dimensions and standards, including our plate, trucks, and containers. So definitely we need an international standard. Well, we're all thinking about setting up an international standard or unified standards. Well, but if you take a look at the transportation conditions domestically and internationally and the size of play, we believe that there is a solution and there is a way out. The OEM, the Chinese OEMs, well, sometimes use the standards from Japan and South Korea. The dimension of the plate is 1.1 meters, and Europe, the European standard is 1 × 1.2 meters. And the United States is very different. the dimensional size of the American standard plate is entirely different from that in Japan and that in Europe. And the same applies to the dimensional size of trucks. Maybe there will be a unified standards across Asia and Europe, but I think it'll be fairly difficult to unify the standards between China and the United States. So from our point of view, well, it's relatively easier to unify the standards between Asia and Europe. China is probably in the middle. We have South Korea and Japan to our east, and Europe to our west. We need to have a global vision. Toyota is in a leading position. Well, Toyota uses the standards of 1.2 times 0.8 meters. Because Toyota has global business presence, and Toyota has a very special supply chain management model. They use their own standards in plate and trucks. Sort of provides a kind of inspiration. In the difficult regions, we're going to push forward our own standards. Take Japanese JPA, for example. They just recently adopted 1 times 1.2 meters as the Japanese national standard. The agricultural plate in Japan is 1 times 1.2 meters. We can start from the dimensional size of the plate, and then we can move into truck. Luckily, starting from last year, we started to implement the GB1589. We allow for one times one plate, but there's another problem with regard to the dimensional size of containers. So the size of the containers is a direct impact upon the dimensional size of the plate and the trucks. The pallet is probably the most fundamental unit in supply chain and logistics. We should start from the very basic thing. The question is how to make sure that the standards of the pallet align with the trucks and containers. The truck standards is universal across Europe and Asia. So maybe next time we should move into a pallet, and then we should move into the dimensional size of containers. We need to optimize some of the links in our supply chain. The trucks, the pallet, the standards can be unified in this regard, but we still need to unify the standards on containers. The whole vehicle as well as the car parts logistic is a big business. China export KD and SKD parts to Europe and Southeast Asia, and China imports a lot of whole vehicles from Europe, so the establishment of the national and international standards will be important. Well, the Chinese government put forward a One Belt, One Road initiative, which is a very, very powerful national strategy. So based upon that initiative, we need to reconstructure the supply chain globally. Well, it's time for us to think in that direction based upon the strong economic power of China. And we should combine Europe and Asia together. We're going to use the new transportation means to improve the efficiency of supply chain. We need to shorten the transportation time, and at the same time, we should also improve the standards of the basic transportation unit, especially the container. In 2006, I had a discussion with a representative from Huashang County on the optimization of the pallet used inside the container. If we can make one breakthrough on one point, it will contribute tremendously to the overall improvement of the supply chain efficiency. We'd love to have more discussions with you in these regards. Let's work together for further integration. It is possible and it is feasible and it is desirable. I attended an ISO conference in Paris on March the 8th, and I believe that we can make some changes. We should reconsider the function of containers. Must we use steel? And can we fold the containers? As with regard to the international standards, we need to reconsider some of the basic elements in this international supply chain. There's a lack of research, investigations, there's a lack of appropriate tests and trials, and we need to work together. Last but not least, I'm going to touch upon the verification. There are different standards in Japan and South Korea and China. For us, certification and inspection, it's not a big problem for us. The key point is just this. It might impede our future communication, that is the custom strategy. We need to have more returnable operations between China and Europe to facilitate the custom clearance. So the standardization of the pallet, the standardization of the containers, would have a direct impact upon the development of the multimodal transportation, which is strongly advocated by the Chinese government. So the custom strategy might become a kind of impediment to further international integration. So we're talking to the customers of different countries very actively, and we are promoting the exchange of pallets across 11 Asian countries. And probably in the future, we need to strengthen our communications with our custom counterparts in European countries. For whole vehicle logistics, there's currently not much to do with regard to the transportation volume, inbound and outbound. Probably in the future, we should focus more on environmental impact. We hope we can establish a supply chain with a positive outlook into the future. We need more cooperation instead of setting up walls against each other. We need this global automotive packaging pooling. This is a market huge enough, and it's a very big topic as to how to set up, how to make this cake even larger. We really need to work together to set up something, to use more international standards, to reduce the cost of logistics and supply chain, to improve efficiency, and to make sure that this returnable operation is possible across different regions and countries. Well, we shouldn't focus only on Asia. The automobile industry is a global industry, and China takes up the biggest share in this industry. So let's work together to reach that consensus and to set up an international supply chain system. Let's go green, let's go smart. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
这种 PPT 给我们讲述了这个国际包装标准的一些。
Okay, great. Thank you. Thanks for a lot. Thanks a lot for your presentation on the latest changes, and you're also addressing some of the specific issues related to the current status of the China's logistics chain. Okay. We are over time already. So still we have a couple of minutes, but not too long, for some questions. So, any questions? You can choose either one of them to answer. Okay, I come from Bosch Asia Pacific Investment Center. My question is for Mr. Sun. Thank you a lot for your sharing with us on the pallet, on the truck standardization for our company and some of the relevant spare part companies. We are also interested in KRLT. The standardized practice for KLTs or the small standardized boxes. So I'm wondering if you have any suggestions to share with us at this moment. Thank you. Well, talking about the small boxes, so this is an internal jargon, and we have actually some companies displaying their small box solutions for the supply chain. Actually, the supply chain should be a complete one rather than a segregated one. We are looking for a road towards the so-called integration of different sizes of boxes. If you go to Europe, you can see a full range of those boxes. So we're going to introduce those special way of managing different sizes of boxes, including label management, including the IT system installment. I hope that we can kick off start such a practice ever since year 2018 to 2019. I think that Continental and Bosch and many other companies may have the relevant spare parts. So outbound will be a little bit quite weak, but inbound, well, I think the trend will be quite apparent. So we can work together to ensure that such a practice can really benefit both sides. I think that probably more people will put that practice into consideration. Secondly, about the standardization. KLT is a German word, but for France it's Galia, but for Japan that's Yio. So probably different countries may have different practices or different standards. To achieve the unified standardized practice, it's a problem. So if you can really accept our standard, no problem, we can give you. Okay, any other questions? Okay, so if you have questions, probably I will raise one. So you don't have to use English to pose your question. For export, you know, it's a double-edged sword. I've been monitoring the rail transportation volume over the past few months. Yesterday, we also heard some presentations about that. The first 3 months, you know, the sales volume of cars is not so high, but if you take a closer look at a mixture, you know, there's a difference between the JV products and also the imported products. So, in other words, we need to really deploy more supply chains outside of China or outbound of China. So my question in this connection for Mr. Huang is about information collection and information deployment. So my question for you is that within your system, so you are planning a system where you can combine a lot of IT developments, right? So any policies or any systematic features that will talk more effectively towards the so-called deployment of your supply chain overseas. Just as what I have mentioned with the relevant changes down the pipeline, originally I prepared two questions, one for Mr. Liu and one for Mr. Huang. So talking about the background, very likely in the future, there will be an increase of export volume from China to other countries because we are going to set up more plants or factories there. So will that mean any changes to our supply chain systems? So based upon connectivities, how to better devise the future system to cope with the need? Thank you, Mr. Zhang, for giving me this chance to describe for you our future plan. Well, different companies may have different understandings for the future industrial development. For example, Changjiu and Anji, they are busy making master plans for the entire sector for their outbound traffic. For our company is a little bit smaller. However, it does not prevent us from thinking big. The spare part for import cars is our area of expertise. So while we are deploying our practice and our expertise overseas, we are doing everything in accordance with the policies and the regulations of the free trade zones in China. This is a very important link. So FTZ policy is a key link based upon which we can set up our own area of expertise to seek westward expansion. In addition, we have to take notice of the changes of the existing policies, how the Chinese government is working actively on the forefront to embrace new policies to support more innovative practices, especially for FTZ. So you know that we have a lot of so-called subsidiary companies launched over the past few months, and in Chongqing and Chengdu, we have our own JVs to the very western part of China, in Horgus and in Urumqi, we have our own outlets. Most of them are 100% owned subsidiary companies of our group. So this is an important step towards providing relevant services, including logistics services, supply chain services, financing services, and IT services to relevant companies between China and the rest of the world. So this is important. Also, we have not only OEMs, but also some trade policy-related services. After we have identified a better understanding of the whole system, we have effected some internal re-regulations and reshuffling. Hopefully, such a practice and such a plan can serve us just as well, and we can share the benefits with all our friends, old and new, in this room. Okay? Thank you. Apart from technological innovation, we are also interested in the model innovation and the connectivity between different innovations. So this is your key point. Next question for Mr. Liu. Two questions. You know, the train arrangement between China and Europe is already becoming a center of attention. You also mentioned about the milk train project. Indeed, we need containerizations. And also in the international container transportation, we also need government policy support and subsidies. But in addition to that, we need much more. Looking ahead into the future, so what is some of the factors that will impact the future sustainable growth of the train arrangement between China and Europe? So in your opinion, what are the areas in which we can seek to better improve our current practice or in any other bottleneck issues? Okay, it's a good question. China-Europe train, regular train, is really something that we are all concentrating our attention on. But at the end of the day, no matter how good the project is, it is only a means, it is not our end. My understanding is that by definition, Belt and Road Initiative means we need to develop our own economy to the benefit of our economies and regions along the road to benefit our people along the road. So for the one belt, it touches upon five connectivities, in which logistics is the basis. So logistics is can be described as the body of a human. For information technology, information technology is the eye of a human. What is the soul? Soul is finance. The finance is the soul of a person. So for such a train arrangement, this is the basis of the Belt and Road, and we have to be equipping, we have to be adequately equipped with the body, eyes, and soul. If finance and information cannot catch up from behind to be equally competent as our body physical strength, this is meaningless. So my point is, I hope that in addition to the opening and the launching of the trains, we need to do more in terms of information sharing and technological improvement. So our current influence is quite limited. But in the future, we hope to really expand the areas in which the influence and impact can be felt. This represents the future step. Okay, thank you. Oh, seems to me that you have already answered the second question from the traditional company to a logistic company, and from a logistic company to an investment company. So how does that talk to the Belt and Road Initiative? In your opinion, so what are some of the bottleneck issues? Actually, you have answered this question, seems to me. Well, I've not considered from this dimension, this issue from this dimension, because back in my days in Xinjiang, I prepared to work on information. By capitalizing upon Bei, though, we hope to open an information channel. When conditions permit, we hope to make more investment in IT-based platforms. I have a partner who is also a logistic player, who currently signed an agreement with China Beidou. So the foreign partners or the external partners may be residing in those areas in which there's no information accessible. So it's difficult to imagine that you have no access to telephone calls or to any of the information, but in those areas it's quite common. So their project is to provide information terminal or portal to provide information or easy access to TV sets and mobile devices whenever the project, the construction project is deployed. So this is a really a good project. Information technology input is key and can be a very good strategy to deliver win-win for both sides. Thank you. Okay, great. So we have to really sharpen our ears and eyes. Lastly, for Mr. Sun, we have so many standards. The packaging standards is the key, is the basis. Last year, the MII launched the recommendations for the standardization of packagings. So, in terms of our current standard compared with Japan and South Korea, so where does our stand now? So this is a technical question. Actually, this is also an issue that I'm interested in. My understanding is that we have to think about everything from the industrial perspective instead of from the policy perspective. In year 2014, the ISO has a standard like 600 by 500. But surprisingly, the national recommendation is 600 by 400. You know, we have some GB or the great, the so-called domestic standards. And also, we have the international standards. You know, 1.1 meter times 1.1 meter spec is more suitable for containers, for the pallets. But for most of the continental regions, we resort mainly for trucks. The trucks actually is benchmarking against Europe, including North America. So 1.2 times 1.2 is quite equivalent to the US standard. They are quite similar to each other, quite close to each other. So that's why we proposed that 600 by 400 is the current recommendation, but I don't think it is one of the most scientific one. 6 by 4 is not the thing that I'm looking for. I hope the future will be an integration. So on 1.2 times 1.2, there could be four compartments or sections. And also you can put it easily also on the plate or the tray on 1 meter times 1 meter. So in my opinion, I think that 600 by 500 will be a proper and a likely standard to go international. 600 times 400 will be more relevant to the European container. So four combined will form one complete container. Otherwise, we have to change the direction of the tray, and so in real practice, it's a little bit inconvenient. We have also made some investigations and also got some surveys for some of the agrarian product manufacturers. They hope to load more, so they said that probably 600 to minus 600 times 400 is more relevant. My personal understanding is that 600 times 500 is more applicable. So, you know, many of the industries in China are concentrated along the sea. Some of the areas have no access to sea, and they have only access to rail. So for us, the biggest challenge is to allow more leeway. Such a leeway may include the coexistence of two different types of plates, because under different conditions, different environments, different specifications will be more practical. And depends on the source of the cargo. So, as I said, 600 times 400 is okay. 600 times 500 is equally okay. Thank you. Okay, so we've been talking too much, and you know, too many standards have been talked about. And the next step is to invite your interest to have some offline discussions with the speakers. So that's all for the second session of the morning. Through our discussion on three dimensions, you have shared with us your expertise on the model innovation, technological innovation, and the standard innovation. All in all, it has pushed forward the development of the practice of lowering the cost and enhancing the efficiency. I hope there will be more breakthroughs along the road. So in line with globalization and integration of the logistics expertise, I hope China can change the original traditional image and try to diversify our experience in more areas in the world. So I hope that the input logistics can embrace a new future. Thank you very much, and I hope you will enjoy the lunch. Thank you. 下午咱们是两